Hello everyone and welcome back to another Kerbal Space Program adventure, and in today's Kerbal Space Program adventure we will be adventuring to the extraterrestrial surfaces of both the Mun and Minmus using the craft that you can see me currently constructing. But oh, what is this craft, you may be wondering? Well, for today's video, I thought I'd do one of my favorite activities in Kerbal Space Program, recreate a ship from history that never were, as in a craft that never made it past the drawing board. I've done a few missions like this before, such as the Saturn VIII and Sea Dragon rockets, but what makes this craft different is that it did actually end up having a test unit built, and it performed some test flights as well. Yes, today we will be recreating the Soviet MiG-105 spaceplane. The MiG-105 was part of the Soviet Spiral program and was a test vehicle to validate the vehicle's design by exploring its low-speed handling and landing. It was nicknamed the Bast Shoe due to the interesting shape of its nose. While the nose shape is a bit difficult to achieve in stock Kerbal Space Program, one thing I can stay faithful to are the interesting delta wings of the machine, which you can see me building here. They were variable dihedral wings. During launch and re-entry, the wings would be folded up at 60 degrees to reduce drag, and then after dropping to subsonic speeds post re-entry, the pilot would then lower them into a horizontal position to give the aircraft better flight characteristics. This is actually fairly similar to how SpaceX's Starship's fins will function as well. As for the rest of the craft, which I haven't yet started building, but you can see when that'll happen using that little time bar indicator thingy at the bottom of the screen. Yes, as for the rest of the craft, Soviet engineers opted for a mid-air launch scheme for Spiral. This was known as the 50-50, and the idea was that the Spiral spaceplane and a liquid-fueled booster stage would be launched at high altitude from the back of a hypersonic jet, something that was never built but would have probably bared design similarities to the Tu-144 supersonic transport or the Sukhoi T-4 supersonic bomber. Definitely had to write those names down before I said them, sorry if my pronunciation was way off the mark. While we can speculate, we'll really never know what the craft would have actually looked like. The flight plan would see the mothership deploy the spaceplane and booster at high altitude, and then the booster would carry the spaceplane the rest of the way to space. From there, it could perform various reconnaissance jobs or possibly deploy a small vessel, if some of the concept videos are to be trusted as a reliable source. And so, in this mission, I've added a small cargo bay to my spaceplane with a small satellite stowed away inside. One compromise I've made with my aircraft is that the spaceplane was designed to land on skids, but I've never had that much success in making skids in KSP, so I went with small landing gear instead. But aside from setting up some action groups and placing some drogue chutes to the back of the Spiral spaceplane, I'd say we're pretty much done with the construction of the spaceplane itself, so now it's time to move along to constructing the launcher. And this is kind of a bit in two parts. We've got the liquid-fueled booster, which you can see me building here, and then we've got the actual hypersonic bomber that'll be deploying this thing at high altitude. So what I'm doing here, the actual concept art for the Spiral shows the liquid fuel booster has these extensions that pass over the Spiral spaceplane a bit like this. I'm presuming for both aerodynamic and structural purposes, but I'm not quite sure, and I'm a bit lazy. I haven't done that. My research has not been that extensive. It's been reading the Wikipedia article and, you know, looking at a few sites here and there. I just really like how the Spiral looks. One thing I will note, though, is that the actual booster here is a very much overkill for a low Kerbin orbit mission, which would be the way of recreating this thing good and proper, given that the Spiral spaceplane was designed to go to low Earth orbit. But I said at the very beginning of this video that this mission is going to take us to the surface of Minmus and Mun, so the Delta V in the spaceplane itself is not going to be quite adequate for fulfilling that mission. So we're going to need a slightly beefier liquid-fueled booster that's going to get us into an orbit slightly higher than a measly low Kerbin orbit. But you have to see how that transpires as we go along. Now, for the actual hypersonic launcher craft, which I'm now constructing here, it's a weird old shape. It's a bit of a hard shape to achieve in stock Kerbal Space Program for amateurs such as myself. I know there are some people, especially on like the Kerbal Planes subreddit, who can build absolutely breathtaking replicas of aircraft using fairings, and like flags are now a thing people use to build structures of aircraft, and no, I'm not good enough. Like, I'm not very good at building like really, really good aircraft replicas, and I just make a fool of myself if I tried. So I'm just going for a basic functional shape. Like, it's a sort of cylindrical looking body, flanked by four very powerful jets, which I'm assuming the closest analog to those would be the Whiplash engines in Kerbal Space Program. So that's what I'm doing here. And that's pretty much, and then I'm going to add some like delta wings to it, but it's not going to be a particularly accurate recreation of the launch craft there. So I'm just sort of getting the actual function of it equivalent and calling it a day, I guess. But that's what I'm doing here. Welcome to my channel, by the way, anyone that has just joined for the first time. But hey, if it is your first time here, guys, I am legally obligated as a YouTuber to say hit that subscribe button. I upload these videos every Saturday, and on Mondays I have a video series called Space This Week, in which we cover space news and we celebrate spaceflight anniversaries, where we look back at historical spaceflight moments. So at some point in the series, I presume, we'll be talking about the actual flight of this space plane when it actually was tested for real. So, you know, if you're interested in that, then there's that series. Especially, like, I imagine there's probably some people that watch my Kerbal videos and haven't really looked at my Space This Week videos. So there you go. That's a little summary of what those are. And hey, you know, shameless plug as well. If you are enjoying this video, then give it a like down below. It really does help out channels quite substantially. So yep, all that good stuff's out of the way. Got that plugged in. We can now move along to covering the stuff you guys are here for, and that is the control surfaces. My goodness, look at that. Yes, obviously, traditionally, aircraft like this, they will have a big tail fin, but given that we have a massive aircraft that needs to be launched off the top of this thing, a tail fin probably wouldn't be that feasible. So we've got those two sort of fins at the ends of the delta wings instead that will provide some horizontal stability, keep our yaw under control as we ascend to the upper atmosphere to ultimately launch the Spiro space plane. Now, I'm not real sure what I was doing there with the color schemes. I think I was just playing around to see if I could get a nice unique look to this plane, but really it just made it very ugly. So we'll be getting rid of that orange color and the ESA color scheme, and we'll be changing the fairing at the front to be white just to make the whole thing look a bit more uniform. But hey, you know, I'm an artiste. What can I say? I like experimenting with color, making things splash, but in this case, it was not a good idea. It just looked very ugly. And that's, I don't think the launch is pretty much done. I think it's just a couple of I's dot T's to cross. Or I did actually replace the SCIF engine just there because, I don't know, I always want to give the SCIF engine a chance. I feel like I never ever use it. It came with the Making History DLC, and I've only ever used it to recreate Saturn V's because that's what that engine is there for. But I'd never really found a practical use for it. There's always a better engine fit for the job, and in this case I tested this craft with the SCIF engine. It didn't really provide the thrust to weight ratio I needed, whereas the Skipper engine did, and it didn't really compromise that much on Delta V. So really the Skipper engine was the better choice for this mission. And there's the cargo loaded up just there, and we're gonna fill up the rest of the cargo bay space with some science experiments. And as you can see, there's a little door on the back of the cockpit, so Kerbals can disembark from the cockpit directly into the cargo bay. Which is a nice feature you might not have known about. If you just click on the cargo bay door, not the cargo bay door, the cockpit door, you can actually choose to EVA Kerbals out of that specific door rather than the default, which is just the cockpit glass dome, I guess. Anyway, we have now faded across from the vehicle assembly building to the runway, which can only mean one thing. It's time to launch this sucker. Yes, we're going to throttle up. Sorry, that was pretty cringe. We're going to throttle up those four Whiplash engines. I'm also going to speed the footage up too. I think we're playing it back at 2x normal speed at the moment because, you know, we can just get the ascent out of the way. This is the boring part of the mission, right? So we're going to just zoom off, and we're going to hold a fairly conservative angle of attack. In this case, I'm aiming for between, you know, 10 and 15 degrees on the nav ball. I found this was the best compromise between helping us pick up lots and lots of speed, but also gaining altitude without gaining altitude too steeply and causing us to stall and then not accelerate very quickly, but also just spending ages in the lower atmosphere building up speed but not really gaining much altitude. So I found this was the best compromise between the two. Once we reach the 10 kilometer mark, which we've now done, we're going to start flying a little bit flatter to make sure we get our surface velocity nice and high. You can see our Mach number there on the top right hand side of the screen, just to the right of the altitude gauge. That's part of the Kerbal Engineer Redux mod. Highly recommend that mod, by the way, if you've somehow not heard of it. Obviously, this is for PC players only, I'm afraid. Sorry, console players. And yes, now I think I was aiming for 700 meters per second as our launch speed. I felt like that would qualify as a good launch speed. I don't really know what the actual bomber's speed would have been to launch the Spiral in real life, but since it never existed, I'm allowed to take artistic liberties. So that's what I aim for, 700 meters per second. And do you see Bob Kerman there? He's currently flying the bomber, but unfortunately, this is not going to be a happy ending for Bob Cummins. We're not playing on my Laon Aerospace, the second one save game, because unfortunately, in Kerbal Space Program, launches like this are just not feasible, because once we deploy the payload, we will either have to choose, basically, do we want to fly the payload and save the payload, or do we want to fly the bomber and save the bomber? We can't fly both. So, yeah, Bob is going to die, I'm afraid, guys. But would you just move away from that fact and get ready to deploy the spacecraft? So I quickly deployed it, switched to the bomber to make it nosedive so it wouldn't just drift upward and slam into the bottom of the spacecraft, causing all kinds of damage we don't want. Then we can quickly switch back to the spacecraft again and fire up the skipper engine and get our way into orbit. So there's Bob coming there. I made a little quick save just there so I can go back and, you know, fly the aircraft to show you it can fly back to the Kerbal Space Center, and then we switch back to this one. Made a second quick save, so now we've got two save points in which we both launched the spacecraft and can fly the spacecraft, and also when we launched the spacecraft but then can fly the bomber. That was a really horrible sentence. I do apologize for that, but I do hope it made sense. I actually chose to not bother going back and fly the aircraft back to the runway, because I feel like you guys have seen that it is capable of flight with this ridiculously large booster on top of it. So I feel like it's a safe assumption that it could probably fly all right without this big booster on it. And this is already quite a long video. I didn't really feel there was any need to artificially drag out the length by showing you the bomber's flight capability when I've already kind of demonstrated that anyway. So F in chat for Bob Cummins, guys. What is your favorite memory of Bob? I'm sure he will be greatly missed. Anyway, we have now depleted all of the fuel in that lower booster, so we can detach it and take control of the space plane. Now, I figured that in real life, that booster would probably only been rated to fire once, so I just did one giant burn to raise our apoapsis as high as we could using that stage, and we almost got to the same height as Minmus. It's only going to be a minor inclination change to get us on a Minmus encounter, as well as a very minor apoapsis adjustment. In this case, just shy of 11 meters per second of burn required to raise our apoapsis to the desired height, and then it's going to be just under 40 meters per second to perform the necessary inclination change to get us on a Minmus encounter. Now, I did say at the beginning of this video that I was going to aim to head to both Minmus and Mun, and I was sort of being a bit dishonest, because yes, we will be landing on both the surface of Minmus and Mun, but not with the spiral space plane. We will be landing on the surface of Minmus using the spiral, and then we'll be deploying its little satellite. In fact, I've actually already deployed the satellite, haven't I? But it'll be the little satellite that the spiral deployed that'll be landing on the surface of the Mun. I did ponder which craft should do which landing, because the spiral does have the Delta V to do a Mun landing, but I don't know, I just like landing planes on Minmus because of the Minmus flats. They're just such a satisfying spot to land spacecraft on, I guess. And I haven't done a Minmus landing in a while, I feel. I can't remember the last time I did a Minmus mission, actually. This is going to be really embarrassing, because someone said, Matt, you did a Minmus landing last week. But I'm pretty sure I didn't. What did I even do last week? I think I did a Lathe mission. No, I did the... No, I did an international... This is my memory, guys, by the way. Hello. yeah, I did an international space station in one launch, didn't I? Which I was... People seem to like that video, so thank you for checking it out, guys. I'm glad you enjoyed it. Yes, so you know, this is a good excuse as any to do a Minmus landing mission. And I guess because this is a new save file, I haven't got any science from Minmus's surface, so we can get some science points from Minmus's surface, I guess. Anyway, now that we're on course to Minmus, we're going to switch to the satellite and perform a correction burn to get ourselves on a Mun encounter, and then once we've performed that correction burn, we'll be switching back to the spiral space plane to circularize at Minmus. So yeah, this satellite is nothing really that fancy. Like, it doesn't have any scientific experiments on it or anything like that. It's literally just a probe core, some batteries, some solar panels, and some aerials, so we can stay in touch with the Kerbal Space Center. But that's it. It's really just a basic dumb probe that I can basically just land it somewhere, and then I can say at the beginning of the video that we landed on the Minmus and Mun, because I'm a dishonest YouTuber, I guess. But I thought it was kind of cool. I do like landing little robotic spacecraft on the moon. And hey, I guess, you know, the first Soviet Mun landers, my goodness, the first and technically only Soviet moon landers were unmanned, so this could be a potential extension of a alternate history Russian space plane program if it weren't for the dissolution of the Soviet Union and end of the space race. One can dream, eh? Anyway, here we are deorbiting the spiral space plane, aiming for some of the flats of Minmus, because they're a great landing spot. And then we can just retract the solar panels and get ready to perform our landing. For most of this video, I was trying to make sure the solar panels were retracted whenever we performed a burn with the engines, just because, I don't know, maybe they're sensitive to sudden acceleration or deceleration when deployed. I know there were a couple of burns in this video where I left them deployed because I was just, I don't know, I guess I just wasn't thinking, I guess. But for most of the burns, I tried to make sure they were always retracted. And of course, with stuff like aero braking later on, we'll be retracting them as well for obvious reasons. And here goes our final touchdown burn here. So we're just gradually heading towards the surface. We're going to make sure we kill off all of our speed just before touchdown so that we can orient the craft into the correct location for it to land on its wheels. Oh, missing that turbojet was millimeters from the surface, but I'm pretty sure it didn't actually make contact. And then we can flip over and land safely. And there we are. Look at Valentina. This is why I love this cockpit. It's got such a cute IVA view. And, well, there we are. Touched down on the surface of Minmus. We can deploy the solar panels. We can recharge our battery supply. And Valentina can go on her EVA. Well, actually, no. Before we do that, let's just run the science experiment to gather the data. And, oh yeah, I brought the magnetometer boom. And I keep forgetting that you've got to be airborne for this thing to work. So I did a quick sort of bunny hop on the surface so we could get some data from the, in air quotes, surface of Minmus, but not technically the surface, that we could actually run the experiment. And now Valentina can go on an EVA and gather the science. And remember when I said you could double-click the door to specify the Kerbal EVAs from that point? I guess I just forgot in this instance that you could do that. I'm pretty sure I'd do it at some point in the video, so it's fine. Oh yes, I accidentally pressed a reset experiment on the Mystery Goo rather than collect the data, so we'll have to quickly re-embark the vessel in a minute to redo that science experiment. Valentina is a pilot Kerbal, so she can't run the experiments from EVA. Before we do that, though, it's important to do the most important part of this mission, and that is, of course, planting our Laon Aerospace flag. Although this isn't the Laon Aerospace save, I'll be damned if I don't have my Laon Aerospace insignia somewhere in the mission. And now we can, I guess, get back on the vessel. On the, oh, very, I mean, Minmus has very, very low gravity, doesn't it? So everything is quite slow. Ooh, bit of a voice crack just there. Everything is quite slow when it comes to Minmus. Anyway, there is a demonstration. Blink and you miss it, but there is a demonstration of me clicking the little door just there and specifying that as our EVA point. But now we've got no time to waste, ladies and gentlemen, because now it's time to switch back to the Mun probe. I don't think I even gave it a name. The Spiral Mun Lander, I guess. I mean, this part of the mission is not quite as exciting because, I don't know, there's something lacking, I think, in... I think one of the great reasons that... One of the things that makes Kerbal Space Program so fun is seeing the little Kerbal faces in the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. Enjoying life, loving everything. Well, at least some of them. I think that's kind of lost when it's a robotic probe mission. In fact, fun fact, some veterans of this channel may remember a series I did called Game of Drones. It was an idea I had where I'd unlock the entire tech tree in science mode using nothing but robotic spacecraft, so no Kerbals at all on any flight, except for the first one because you don't get a probe core right away, so just walking a Kerbal around the space center to unlock a probe core and then from then on only using the probes. But I realized that it's actually kind of boring because one of the most fun things to do in Kerbal Space Program is to take your little aliens somewhere. They can get out and plant a little flag and you can see their little faces, and when it's just robotic spacecraft, I don't know, it seems a bit... He's a bit lame, so I'm not sure what I'm trying to get across here. I'm really just trying to sell the rubbishness of this part of this mission, it would seem. But I don't know. Still think it's kind of cool that this was deployed from the Spiral spacecraft. And as you can see, we have lots and lots of Delta V left in this thing. So we can hop around lots of different biomes on the Mun, provided we are on the light side of the Mun, because the Mun is tidally locked to Kerbin, and we need to be, you know, in view of Kerbin for those aerials to connect to the Kerbal Space Center. But nonetheless, we can still do a lot of chartering. And even though this thing doesn't have any scientific instruments, we can see it. So it's like it has a camera. So it's like a photography. It's a Mun observation probe. So I don't know, guys. I'm just trying to justify it, really. Anyway, now we can go back to the exciting part of the mission, and that is the ascension of the Spiral Space Plane. So the first thing I'm going to do is save a, albeit negligible, amount of Delta V by pointing us along the 90 degree vector, which will make sure we ascend with the rotation of Minmus to gain a little bit of extra Delta V. And then we can deploy the brakes and get ready for takeoff. retracting those wings for no real reason other than the fact it looks cool. And then we can kick off using that little monopropellant engine on the front and firing those. I mean, like, Bimus's gravity is so low that the reaction wheels on this thing could have done that maneuver as well. But I thought it looked kind of cool having the little monopropellant thruster to raise the nose. And when I designed this thing, I wasn't quite sure if I'd want to land it on the Mun. And hey, if you guys choose to download this craft from the description, it'll make sense from the Mun easier if you choose to take this thing to the Mun, having that little monopropellant engine on the front of the craft. And now we can, I don't know, deploy the wings again, because it does look a bit cooler having those wings in the deployed state. We'll leave the solar panels retracted until we've performed our circularization burn. I think we might even leave them retracted until we do our not interplanetary, but once we've left Mimus's sphere of influence, because that's going to be quite a bit. It's a bit of a long old journey back to Kerbin, put it that way. So we are circularized. Now we can plot a course back to Kerbin and ultimately back to the Kerbal Space Center runway. Yeah, we're going to be going back to the runway, guys. Do not worry. So, yeah, just performing a little burn there. Now, I didn't think I had quite enough delta V to get away with not doing any aero braking at all. So we'll be doing, I think, one or possibly two aero brakes just to lower our apoapsis down a little bit. But then the rest of the slowing down will be done using engines, just because this thing doesn't tolerate heat all that well, particularly the nose cone at the front and that little monopropellant engine as well. That doesn't have a very high heating tolerance. But also, this thing doesn't fly particularly well when it's full of fuel. So one way you could improve upon this thing, if you were to download it from the description, would be to add some sort of drain valve. So once you've completed your mission and you're ready to head back to Kerbin, if you've still got lots and lots of fuel left, rather than trying to balance out the fuel tanks unsuccessfully, you could just drain any excess fuel and that will make it fly a little bit better. I designed this thing to fly well when empty, because that's how I would have assumed people would be flying this thing in the atmosphere, because you'd have used all the fuel up doing the orbital mission or whatever it is you were doing with it. I mean, I think it's got enough delta V for Gilly as well. Or you can even do like a Juno flyby. So there's lots of different things you could use this craft for. I kind of want it to have a practical purpose, even though I say that out loud, but it's really not a very practical craft at all. The space plane is, but the actual ridiculous hypersonic launch system, not so much. So I'm just dropping our, our periapsis down to, I think I went for 56 kilometers. I'm literally just reading it off the screen, so I'm patronizing you guys a bit, assuming you weren't reading it as well, but I don't know, maybe some of you are just watching something on the other, on your second monitor or something and not paying attention. So, guys, yep, we're over here. Come on, watch the video. Anyway, yes, we're going to start our first re-entry aero brake. So I did say at the beginning of the video that the actual real spiral would have retracted its wings, as in raised them into a vertical orientation for re-entry, but I don't know, I wanted to reduce our apoapsis fairly quickly, and by having the wings in a deployed position means we produce a little bit more drag, makes the mission go by a little bit quicker. So we've done our air brake. That's all we really needed to do, to be honest. You might have seen some temperature gauges started creeping even with a periapsis as high as that. So I thought the rest of our apoapsis lowering can be done using the engines. We've got the delta V and we really want to use as much fuel up as possible now before we do our final Kerbin re-entry. But that's that maneuver node all plotted and all final, so not much more to do now other than just time warp down to our maneuver node point and begin our retrograde burn, which is a fairly long burn, you know, 828 meters per second, which translates to just over 2 minutes of burn time with these Twitch engines, because their thrust weight ratio isn't particularly great. Luckily, with the power of time warp and post-production video fast forwarding, it doesn't take that long for the video for you guys. So there we are, nearly circularized. 3, 2, 1. Oh, I guess that's it. Not quite circular. What do I do? Oh, never mind. I did a quick puff of retrograde because I like just being all precise and all that. So now we're going to aim for the Kerbal Space Center, but it doesn't matter if we overshoot or undershoot a little bit, because you may have noticed that this thing does have a little jet engine at the back of it, and I didn't just add that for my own convenience. The actual real spiral space plane was designed to have a jet engine mounted to its posterior. In fact, it did. The test flights of the vehicle were done under its own power using the little jet engine, and it would have just helped pilots get back to their landing site if they weren't quite on target with their Earth re-entry. Very nearly said Kerbin re-entry just there. Anyway, we have now lowered our periapsis to be within Kerbin's atmosphere, so we can shut down those Twitch engines and lock their gimbal as well, so they don't twitch around. Haha, get the pun. And annoy me. And then we can make sure we... I guess I've actually deployed the wings a little bit prematurely. I really should have paid more attention whilst I was flying this thing, but I don't know. This thing can re-enter fine with them I did notice that I was about to overshoot quite extensively, but rather than just reloading an earlier quick save and trying again and trying to get things a little bit more accurate, I thought, you know what? We don't need to glide back to the Space Center's runway perfectly, because this gives me a good opportunity to show this thing flying under its own power using that little jet engine. So there we are. Again, the jet engine, I couldn't get quite accurate to the real thing. That air intake is much, much bigger than the one the Spiral would have used, and the Spiral's air intake would have been covered by a hatch during hypersonic flight and re-entry, and then that hatch would have opened up once flight was needed. But I think, you know, whilst it's not obviously a one-to-one perfect replica, I think this gets all the right stuff correct, I think. And at the end of the day, it's an alternate history craft that never technically flew, so I can take artistic liberties here and there. And here we are on our runway approach. We have deployed the landing legs. Now we can just get ready for touchdown. As you can see, this thing can glide quite well at fairly low speed, so landing is an absolute breeze. And then once we've touched down, a little bit of a wobble, but it all stayed upright, so it's fine. And then we can deploy our drogue chutes to slow ourselves down. And once we get down to a really slow speed, I'm going to activate the brakes to come to a complete standstill. And I guess that's it. That's the flight. I really hope you enjoyed this, actually, guys. I really enjoyed flying this craft. It's one of my favorite craft just looking at it. It's such a cute space plane. Oh, I love it. I'd like to do more of it. Or like maybe, you know, spacecraft that looked like this, like the Dream Chaser, I believe, was one. Something like that. Or there are other small space planes from various space agencies from around the world, like India's space plane, which I've completely forgotten the name of, so I do apologize. But yes, they've got a cute little space plane that they have tested. Maybe that could be something I could recreate. Who knows? Let me know down below what your thoughts are. And yeah, we can deploy the wings, I guess, and call the video a wrap on screen. There's an end screen. The left-hand side is a link to a video chosen for you by YouTube's recommendation algorithm. The video on the right is a link to my most recent upload, which I believe you guys watching this on the day it's uploaded will be a Planet Coaster video. The description has links to other social media and merchandise and stuff, so that's there if you want it. And that's the end of the video.